Hello to everyone out there in the ether. I'm Barry B. Man Benning, and this is Film Nobs. To you first-time listeners out there, welcome to the show. And to you returning listeners, welcome back. And to all of you out there, thank you. Thank you so much for choosing to spend a little bit of your time with me today, because I know just how valuable time is, how precious it is. It's one of the most precious commodities that any one of us have. So, acknowledging that fact, I don't want to waste any more time, and let's just get down to the core, the very essence, the driving force of today's episode. Wait a sec. Before I tell you exactly what it is, let me just point out that what it represents is something that I hold very close to me. I practice it on a daily basis, and I've done so for most of my life. Most of my family, at least on my dad's side, has adhered to this philosophy, if you will, as do a great number of the people who gravitate within my sphere. And what it is, well, I'll tell you what's got me so excited. I'm very excited because within the next couple of weeks is there's going to be an observance. It's an observance, a celebration of what I'm talking about. It's been an official observance, or, you know, maybe non-official, I'm not really sure. For the last 10 years, been recognized, let's say, for the last decade or so, as it should have been. And, well, long story short, I'm talking about procrastination, of course. And this is upcoming. It's going to be National Procrastination Week. So excited about this. The National Procrastination Week is observed for 2 weeks, sometime during the first couple of weeks of March, give or take, like I say, I've seen it start on the 2nd before the 4th, whenever. I think usually it's probably decided upon after the month has gone by each year as to when exactly it did start and finish, but sometime within the first 2 weeks of March. Again, it's an observance, not a national holiday or anything, but I'm pretty sure that eventually it will be. Once people get around to it, I'm sure they'll make it a national holiday. Now, how I intend on celebrating National Procrastination Week is I'm going at it the exact opposite of how it's intended. Procrastination, of course, putting off things that need to be done simply because you don't want to face life sometimes. Basically, that's it. You don't want to face life, so you just put it off. I, however, am going to celebrate this year with all of you. I'm going to celebrate by having a show in which I talk about some of the things that I probably should have already talked, that I've put off a little bit. And I think what we'll do is we'll recap the Oscars from this last year. Of this recording, this episode's recording, it's been a week or so since the Oscars were announced, and I probably should have done this a few days ago, but I'm going to do it now. And I think I also, while I'm talking about this past Oscar show, and there's certainly a lot to be talked about there, I may either during that conversation, I may talk about the year 2018 in review. I'll tell you this right now. Film Nobs here recently has been undergoing some growing pains, I guess, some changes, and I really haven't had the chance to do that review show that I wanted to do. So we're going to do an abbreviated version, at least, of it this show, and I think I'll feel pretty good getting that off my chest. This show will be therapy for me, and hopefully entertainment for all of you. So let's talk about the 91st Academy Awards that happened a week or so ago as of this recording. It was a hostless night, although it had not been planned as such. Originally, comedian Kevin Hart had been pegged to be the Oscar host this year, but that came into jeopardy when some old posts were unearthed, along with some of his old comedy bits that contained some homophobic slurs and language. So Hart eventually backed out, and after some unsuccessful attempts at the Academy trying to go get some of its previous Oscar hosts to do duties this year, it was decided that they would just go hostless. Now, some of my friends weren't entirely happy with that idea. They believe that a host holds things together, acts as the glue that keeps things as seamless as possible, which can be a tough job if you consider all the egos that are present in the room at that one time, the pressure of the telecast itself, and on top of all that, all the controversies that have swirled around the telecast in recent years, all the questions about diversity, the debacle of the wrong picture being announced for Best Picture a couple of years ago, the aborted attempts to try to shorten the telecast this year, all of the suggestions met with derision. It's no surprise that it's hard to find a host for this tough job. And getting back to my friends who like the idea of having a host, personally for me, I like the idea of having a host too. And it's great when you have a good host like Billy Crystal or Bob Hope, Johnny Carson, Ellen DeGeneres, people who instinctively know how to work a room, who are pros at it. But one other problem the Oscar telecast has had in the last few years or more has been extreme over-length. The 2018 Oscar telecast clocked in at 3 hours and 50-something minutes. And that's yet another factor that's been hurting the Oscar ratings. That 2018 telecast, as we mentioned in the Film Nobs Oscar preview episode, that was the lowest rated show in Oscar history. Flash forward to this year's telecast, 2019, we have a hostless show, that clocks in at 2 hours and 20-something minutes, a full half hour shorter than last year's. And we have ratings that went up 12%. So, as much as I like the idea of having a host, a good host, if it can save us half an hour, I'm willing to try this again. I'm willing to try this hostless Oscar telecast idea one more time. And I have a feeling that ABC and the Academy may want to try it again as well. However, a couple of things do bear mentioning here. One is that this year's Oscar telecast, while getting, as I mentioned earlier, a 12% bump in ratings, which put it around 29 point something million viewers this year, it was still the second lowest rated Oscars ever. And that's even with three blockbuster movies being nominated for Best Picture. So, you know, maybe this is the new norm. Maybe with so many other things, so many other distractions to keep us occupied, younger people more especially, maybe this is close to the ceiling here as far as this type of ratings, as far as this type of ratings to be expected going forward. But, you know, in the end, the big number here for me personally is 30. 30 minutes cut short on the show, time-wise. And as I said at the beginning of this episode, time is one of the most important things that we have. And, you know, that's 30 more minutes of my time that I have to choose to put off any number of jobs, projects, responsibilities, anything like that. So, that's a big plus. Also, a good night for diversity. And that's been a topic that has troubled the Academy over the last few years. A lot of people believing that the Academy hasn't shown enough inclusion. This year, they certainly did show inclusion. There were a record number of women that took home an Oscar, 15, I believe. There were also a record number of black winners, with 7 taking home awards, including Black Panther's costume designer, Ruth E. Carter, who became the first black woman to win in that category. And also from Black Panther, Hannah Beechler became the first black woman to win for Best Production Design. Those are historic wins. And also, as a matter of fact, those two Oscars were the first two Oscars that a Marvel Cinematic Universe picture has ever won. So, big for a couple of reasons. Spike Lee won his first competitive Oscar. Mahershala Ali wins his second Best Supporting Actor in the last 3 years. I guess it's two out of the last 3 years. Rami Malek. Actually, you had of the four acting awards that were given out last night, three were to people of color. I believe that's the first time that's ever happened. You had Ali, of course. Regina King, who won for If Bill Street Could Talk. And Rami Malek for Bohemian Rhapsody. So, a pretty big night, and I, for one, and well, not for one, a lot of people, I'm sure, are happy to see that. There were several fun moments, some nice moments to watch. One of my favorites being Mike Myers and Dana Carvey getting into their old Wayne's World characters as they presented Bohemian Rhapsody for Best Picture. It was great seeing those two guys together again. And then there was Regina King when she was announced as Best Actress. On the way up, she seemed to be having some slight wardrobe malfunctions. So Chris Evans gallantly getting up out of his seat and helping her partway up the stairs, making sure that she was fine. I thought Melissa McCarthy and Brian Tyree Henry presenting Best Costume was pretty amusing. Billy Porter's velvet tuxedo gown. That was certainly interesting to watch before the show during the red carpet ceremonies. Then there was the duet. The duet everybody was talking about between Lady Gaga and Bradley Cooper as they sang the eventual Best Song winner, Shallow. There was enough chemistry there between the two of them to certainly start some tongues wagging afterward. And maybe the best moment for me overall, personally, on a personal level, was the moment that Green Book took Best Picture, because that allowed me to tie with my cousin Steven in our annual Oscar pick battle. And I never beat him. It's crazy. I usually see more movies than he does every year. And I would think that would help me, that, you know, I should have the advantage over him, but invariably he just beats me every year. This year I told him, and as I said the pre-Oscar show, that I was going to go with Green Book for Best Adapted Screenplay, and if it won that, it would win Best Picture. And it did win both those awards. Let me sneak in for the tie. And now that I say that, it kind of embarrasses me a little bit to think that I was that excited about a tie. Anyway, I tell you what, let's go look at some of those Oscar winners, and let's see what we can talk about with them. Well, the first one I was going to mention is the Best Documentary. Best Documentary winner was Free Solo. Before the Oscars, or before the announcement, I had seen what I thought was going to be three movies that would be nominated, to be honest with you. I'd seen Won't You Be My Neighbor, which I actually thought would win. Before it was even nominated, I thought, there's your winner. I'd seen Three Identical Strangers and Shirkers. I thought all three of those might get an Oscar nomination. As it turns out, none of them did. So I was shut out of the whole category. However, the best movie that I saw personally, I thought the best film experience I had last year was a documentary. It was Peter Jackson's Before They Grow Old, a World War I documentary. Is just stunning, technically, and so moving. But that movie wasn't eligible. The filmmakers didn't submit it to the Academy in time to be considered for that category. I believe the cutoff date is somewhere around October, and I don't know why they didn't do that, but they didn't, nor did it play in L.A. or New York long enough anyway. But I will plug that movie whenever I get the chance, and I believe as of this recording, it is still playing in some cities. So if you do have a chance to check that out, please do. Best Foreign Language winner surprised absolutely no one. Roma is kind of embarrassing. That was the only film I'd seen in that category. So the more I think about this, I usually try to get to as many foreign films as I can every year. So maybe that will be my topic, or at least one of my topics, during next year's National Procrastination Week episode. I'm going to make this a thing. It may or may not be in March when I do. It may end up being well past the point. I may be lazier about it next year. But I certainly, you know, at the very least, I wanted to see Cold War and Shoplifters. And hopefully within the next few weeks, I'll be able to find one or both of those films somewhere. The best animated film was one of, if not the, my personal favorite to see win the other night, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. If that movie hadn't won, I was going to be so angry, because it is a real, again, I've said it before, a real movie of the moment. It's so fresh, so original, and just a joy to watch. The older I've gotten, the fewer animated films I see a year, and that's probably another thing I need to work on. But you know, if I could get this kind of pleasure out of it, maybe I need to start going to see more, because I just absolutely love that film. And there were a couple of others that I saw this year that were fine. Isle of Dogs, Anderson's movie, was really good. And Incredibles 2, that a lot of people thought, at least for a few months, was going to probably win that award, until Spider-Man came swinging through the buildings late in December. That was a fun movie as well. Not near as Not near as good as the original, but or not as good as the original, but still a fine movie. The best special effects winner. All right, most people are going to. I think most people thought that the best actress winner was the Shock of the Night, but I don't think so. No, not at all, actually, because while in that award, Olivia Colman was the number two. If it wasn't Glenn Close, it was going to be Olivia Colman. This category, though, everybody I talked to and myself personally, I thought that this might have been another easy pick to win. It was Avengers Infinity War. You know, you've got an entire movie that is just one great special effect after another. And the winner went to First Man. And that's just a shocker. I think that's one of the biggest shockers to me in years. And it's not because the effects in First Man were poor. They were not poor at all. But they just, I think they were dwarfed, certainly in number. And, again, it's just Infinity War is a special effects movie. Done, you know, with the effects done well. First Man, a drama with some good special effects. And the only thing I could come up with here is that maybe Academy members were, they were going to award something with a little bit more verisimilitude. It seemed, you know, they did pull off something. It probably looked that way, if you know what I mean. Maybe I'm not explaining that well enough. The effects looked real. It looked like that's probably how it went down, how it happened. And as such, maybe, you know, and then maybe they were, maybe the Academy also decided that three awards for Black Panther was enough for the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Maybe that's all they, wanted to give those guys. I don't know. It was puzzling though. So First Man, wins the Best Special Effects Award. And as far as Best Sound Mixing and Editing are concerned, those two awards. Now, I thought it should win those two awards. The sound work in First Man was amazing. You know, it's one of those movies that really makes you realize how important sound is to a movie. Most people, they kind of forget about it. They take it for granted. You can't see it. But so it doesn't win. Of course, it doesn't win either of those. Both of those awards, both the sound awards going to Bohemian Rhapsody, which became, I guess, surprisingly late in the year, the Oscar darling as far as musicals go, overtaking that spot from A Star Is Born. And musicals, not unsurprisingly, seem to do well in the sound categories. So it swept it. And the love for Bohemian Rhapsody didn't end there, of course, with the sound awards. It also won, and this surprised me too, it won Best Editing. Now, usually, Best Editing seems to go to like the flashiest movie, the one where you notice the editing the most, and I don't know if that's a good thing all the time. It just, but it does seem like the editing that draws attention to itself is the type that the type of movie that wins. And this year, Vice seemed to fit that bill. Now, I thought Vice would win that category. It had the showier editing. But Bohemian Rhapsody, and I think probably because of the last concert scenes that were put together very well in the film, that might have been enough to push it over. And I believe, if memory serves me right, all five of those nominees were also nominated for Best Picture. And that's another, a lot of times, another indicator of what the Best Picture is going to be is what wins Best Editing. I don't know exactly why. Of course, editing is a very crucial part of filmmaking, very crucial element. But this year, the editing winner, neither the flashiest nor the eventual Best Picture winner. Best Original Song was another, that was another award along with Best Foreign Film. that was pretty easy to predict. It was one of the sure locks of the night. And that, again, that Lady Gaga-Bradley Cooper duet certainly got a lot of people talking. Gaga's vocal performance live quite predictably overshadowed her partner's, but he did a good enough job hanging in there with her live. Good enough to where one of the moments that we didn't see on the live telecast was when the two of them returned to their seats from being backstage, and they were met with another standing ovation. So it was one of the high points of the night. Best Makeup Award was actually another pretty sure winner as well. Vice won Best Makeup and Hairstyling. And while I think that it deserved that award, this led to maybe the worst moment of the night. And it was just indicative of why they still have a lot of work to do with the Oscar telecast. It was like they didn't even know that they were up for the award or something. When they went up to the stage, there were three winners. I can't remember who it was now. But they were completely flustered. They couldn't even read. I believe they had prepared speeches or they had notes, and they seemed to be unable to even read those. And I know that it must be an overwhelming moment, good Lord, to be in front of, you know, all of your peers and then to be seen across the world in such a large telecast. But man, you got to get it together a little bit more than that. And, you know, that was actually one of the categories the Academy decided at one point they weren't going to show live. They were going to record it during a commercial break and then edit it into the show later on. And it's looking like that would have been a good call on that one. The winners need to realize that their show is running horribly long. And while I know the winners worked hard and they've got a lot of people they need to thank, too many people, they can't thank them all, the truth is something's got to give as far as that goes eventually. The Academy has tried to come up with a couple of things to shorten the telecast, and it looks like the no-host thing definitely is a very good start maybe to cutting time down. But if winners can't control themselves once they get up on stage to accept their awards, well, they just do need to learn how to control. Either that, or they are going to have to go to something unpopular among Academy members, like presenting awards during commercial breaks. That's just the long, hard truth of it. And people have got to come to grips with that. Black Panther scored three wins last night, along with Green Book and Roma. They were one award. Good lands. I'm about to, I think there's cat wars behind me. I may have to go break this up. But all right, guys, settle down. The joys of seamless podcasting. Anyway, yeah, they were all one behind Bohemian Rhapsody, which won four Oscars. But anyway, as I said, Black Panther scoring three wins, and one of those wins being best score. And that was a little bit of a surprise to me. I thought that either BlacKkKlansman, Terrence Blanchard would win that, or if Bill Street could talk. But it was Ludwig Göransson for Black Panther, which also went on to win, as I mentioned earlier, Best Costume Design and Best Production Design. Ruthie Carter for the former, and Hannah Beisler and Jay, I believe it's Jay Hart, for production design. And I thought they were both deserving winners for each of those categories. Cinematography went to Alfonso Cuarón for Roma, for that luscious, rich black and white photography. That was another much well-deserved win. I think he's the first best director winner. He goes on to win best director, by the way. He's the first Best Director winner to have won the Best Cinematography Award for shooting his own movie, I think. I may have to, if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. I was about to say I just go edit out, but no, I'm not going to do it. I'll roll the dice on that one. Best Adapted Screenplay went to Spike Lee. Again, his first competitive award. And I thought that win was a pretty good choice from the Academy as well. And his acceptance speech and the moment that he won that was one of the more indelible moments of the 91st Academy Awards, because you could just see the pure unadulterated joy that Spike had winning that. And he was so happy that he had a lot of trouble. He had his speech ready. He had a speech on paper, but he couldn't quite get it out near as well as he probably wanted to. But he certainly had a few strong statements to make that he did get out that caught our president's attention, let's say, afterwards. I was talking with my cousin after that award, and he mentioned something about it. It certainly seemed odd that Samuel L. Jackson was a presenter of that award, because Spike gave him his start, I believe. I want to say that Jungle Fever might have been Sam Jackson's first movie. And, you know, so when Spike wins, he comes up on the stage and just jumps into Samuel's arms. And it made for great television, made for a great moment. But they always say that Price Waterhouse, right, is Price Waterhouse representatives are the only ones that really know who wins the award. although the Moonlight La La Land debacle a couple of years ago makes you wonder just, you know, how truthful they are. But I guess it was my take that, even though that does seem a bit curious, there was a real good chance that Spike Lee was going to win that award. He was the heavy favorite. And I'm sure the Academy, you know, knew that. And so it was probably just a roll of the dice to have Samuel Jackson up there to give him the award. I don't know that it necessarily means the cat was out of the bag, but what would have been really interesting maybe if Spike hadn't won and Samuel Jackson was up there. That could have made for even more dramatic television, folks, and more controversy. But moving on to original screenplay, Nick Vallelonga, Brian Curry, and Peter Farrelly won for Green Book. And I thought this was, again, maybe the crucial award of the night and would be an indicator for the possible Best Picture winner. The Green Book writers, they won the Golden Globe and a couple of other awards earlier and looked to be the favorite. Then certain things that were said by one of the writers and by Farrelly kind of, I guess, cast a cloud of doubt upon whether the movie could sustain its momentum. I figured if it did, whatever would win this, because you had The Favorite was also nominated. Roma was also nominated for Best Screenplay. Those were the three favorites. I figured the winner between the three of those would go on to win Best Picture, and that is what happened. We'll talk more about Green Book when we get to that Best Picture. Best Director, again, no real surprise. Alfonso Cuarón picks up his second Oscar. Not personally my favorite last year. I think Roma, I'm one of those people that think Roma, while a very good movie, beautiful movie to look at with with some very strong moments was just a little too slow. I didn't quite like it as much as some of the men. They're all men nominated. And that's another thing, you know, while we can celebrate some diversity this year among our Oscar nominees and winners, there weren't any female nominees again in the Best Director category. And there were several worthy, including Chloe Zhao of The Rider and Deborah Granik of Leave No Trace, among others. But of the five men that were nominated, I think I might have had to go with Spike again for BlacKkKlansman. Of the five that are nominated, I thought his direction on BlacKkKlansman was inspired at moments. So. And then Best Supporting Actor, Mahershala for Green Book, wins his second in the last 3 years. He won a couple of years ago for Moonlight. I have, again, no problem with that. It would be hard to argue against that. Personally, you know, I would like to have seen Sam Elliott pick one up. He's just, you know, he's been one of those guys that's kind of undervalued through the years. And I've got a soft spot for underdogs, so I wouldn't have minded seeing that. Best Supporting Actress, Regina King, If Beale Street Could Talk. I didn't see that. That's the one. I saw the other four. Saw the other four nominees. I didn't see her in that. She was the favorite. She does pull through there. Best Actor, Rami Malek. Very deserving for Bohemian Rhapsody. I don't know if he was my favorite last year, my personal favorite, but you know, Viggo Mortensen was pretty, even though he's nominated for Best Actor, it's almost like he was overlooked. You had Willem Dafoe, Bradley Cooper, Christian Bale, and at one time Christian Bale was the heavy favorite to win that, but the Bohemian Rhapsody train took off from the station in December, late December, and rolled on through. But again, I had no problem with that winner. And also there, Rami had, I thought, one of the better acceptance speeches of the night. But both he and the Best Actress winner, Olivia Colman. I enjoyed both of their speeches. And Olivia Colman, again, a lot of people consider Olivia Colman, her win over Glenn Close for The Wife to be the shocker of the night. It certainly was a surprise. I mean, Glenn Close, that was, I think that was her seventh nomination, and she now may be numero uno by herself as far as actors who have been nominated the most times without winning. Olivia Colman, though, was the second favorite. I don't think many people would have placed her chances lower than third for sure, but certainly I think most people had her pinned in as the number two at second best odds. Let's put it that way: second best odds of winning Best Actress. And her speech was. She seemed to be as bewildered as a lot of other people were about her win. It was pretty funny. Yeah, you know, she talked about her kids, you know, maybe watching at the time. If they didn't, that would be the only time she would ever be up there. You know, she was certainly probably pretty honest about that. And she almost seemed apologetic to Glenn Close, who in the reaction shots, the camera shots on Glenn, Glenn was very classy. And she didn't seem disappointed at all. She seemed to find humor in what Olivia was saying. But like I said, it seemed like Olivia was almost apologizing for the win. But she shouldn't have. It was a great performance. And finally, we move along to the Best Picture winner, which was, again, Green Book. And Green Book has already proven to be a controversial win for Best Picture. And it's problematic. There's strong opinions on several sides about this movie. I don't think I'm going to get into a lot of the politics of this film. There's enough here for a full show, and I think I may revisit this topic and talk about this more in depth. I'll just say, on a personal level, just a short answer, I thought it was a very good pick. It was my favorite movie of all of the nominees, and I don't have a big problem with that. But then again, that's my viewpoint, and I certainly respect and see what some other people are saying about it. I see where the problems come from. I just don't particularly agree with certain viewpoints as they relate to this particular movie. It's a complicated, certainly a very complicated subject. And in the meantime, while I'm trying to, I guess, marshal my thoughts, I will try to marshal my thoughts and opinions about Green Book into another show on down the line in the future. Until then, I know that one of the better arguments for Green Book and for some of the problems that have been brought up about it, I found by reading Kareem Abdul-Jabbar's article in The Hollywood Reporter, came out, I believe, in, I don't know if it was December or January of this year, but it's a pretty well-written article that I think is an essential read if you have a strong opinion, or even if you don't. It's a very good read. And yeah, it's Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, again, the former NBA great. So I guess that's about it as far as my 91st Academy Award post game show goes. Certainly, again, some very good moments and some not so good moments. But overall, I think it was a better show than the previous year or two. But in the end, the Oscars, that's not the biggest awards. That's not what's important. What's important is my year-end overview, something that I haven't done. I didn't get a chance to. Haven't had a chance to do that. And we'll do it kind of briefly. And I guess I'm going to start. I'm looking down at my shirt here. I'm actually wearing a T-shirt right now. It says Happy Festivus. And so I'm looking at some of my notes over the year, and so I think the Happy Festivus thing is convincing me that I'll go with not the best of what I saw last year, but I'm going to go with the worst. This is going to be an airing of grievances per Festivus tradition, and this is something I don't really like to do, at least as much as I used to. I don't like to carp on the negative very much. There's enough of that in the world, right? There's a lot of it, at least. And it's hard work making a movie. It's hard work making any kind of movie, good or bad. And I've got to that point. The older I've got, I go, oh my gosh, it's a miracle that any movie gets made. If you think about how many people are involved, how many huge egos are involved usually, how many differing opinions. So sometimes I feel a little bad now about coming down on movies, but look, some movies, they just deserve it. I'm just going to mention a few. Some of the worst I think I saw last year. Winchester was a huge disappointment with Helen Mirren, who I adore. I love that woman. I've loved her for a long time. And that movie was just... And it was an interesting premise, interesting concept, but it was just a cheap-looking, boring mess. Well, speaking of boring messes, that reminds me of another horror movie from last year, Suspiria. And certainly that was one of the most disappointing movies that I saw last year. I had high hopes for that, but yeah, it was just a 2.5-hour, never-ending... At least Winchester wasn't pretentious. Suspiria was just laden with so much pretension that I think I have even more against Suspiria than I do Winchester. Another horror movie that I had several things against was the Nicolas Cage-led Mandy. Just a totally unpleasant and illogical revenge movie. It defies description. And ironically, as me saying this, I mean, I've got Mandy on my worst of the year list, mainly due to the script and just the unpleasant nature of it. That being said, there's a good chance that I would have given it consideration in two Oscar categories for best score and best cinematography. It was at times a startlingly inventive looking movie to watch, but yeah, it's strange to say that a movie on my worst list I would nominate in two categories, but such is the paradoxical, contradicting life of a professed film lover. Hellfest would be another horror movie that I would throw into the worst mix. And that, again, this is another movie that kind of frustrated me a little bit because there was the seed of a good idea for a horror movie here. And there were some interesting visuals, some interesting lighting schemes in the movie. But it was a below average, I guess, slasher flick that really didn't have an interesting killer at all, and was pretty by the book, other than its premise. I would throw the Jennifer Lawrence Russian spy thriller Red Sparrow into the mix as one of the worst films I saw last year. Just absolutely ridiculous scenes peppered throughout that movie, especially the ones that were set at this Russian school. Russian spy school, and Lawrence allowed herself to do a couple of scenes that I'm pretty surprised that someone of her stature would allow to happen. They were pretty embarrassing. Along with the whole movie is just a mess. There's some sci-fi Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom that was even for a movie that doesn't really necessarily need to make a lot of sense. It was still stupid. It was a lot worse than the first Jurassic World, and I wasn't particularly a big fan of it. It had some good special effects in it, but Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom was not good at all. The Fantastic Beasts sequel, The Crimes of Grindelwald, was very disappointing, along with, I tell you, another couple of disappointing movies. Searching, the missing child movie starring John Cho, which got some pretty good notices across the board. I found that, and initially, the movie started out pretty good. I was sucked in initially, but it had such an illogical, unbelievable conclusion to it that it completely marred the whole movie. Absolutely killed it. From about the third act, the start of the third act on, that movie fell apart completely. That and here's a movie that will, I'm going to put on the worst list that will tick off a lot of movie snobs out there. I mean, I consider myself kind of a, look, I'm a movie knob, which you know, snob, you just add the S, right? I'm pretty close to that. But I was not a fan of Lynn Ramsey's You Were Never Really Here, starring Joaquin Phoenix. That movie made a lot of best lists this year, but I found it, again, to be just kind of overwrought and pretentious, and I didn't care a whit about anything going on in that movie. I'm way in the minority as far as critics go, but I tell you what, I will ask anybody out there, let me know what not only of that movie, but let me and all of us at Film Knobs know what you're thinking. What were some of your favorite movies this year? And like we're talking about right now, what are some of the worst? What were some of the worst movies you saw? I'd be very curious to see this. So drop us a line on Twitter or YouTube or Facebook. We'd love to hear from you. Now, there were several other movies that I saw during the year that were disappointing. Some of them, some of these are not particularly bad movies. They're just, I expected more out of them. Game Night, I thought Game Night, considering some of the cast and premise of that, I thought that would be a funnier movie. It was occasionally amusing, but not near as good as I had hoped. The two Dwayne Johnson movies, Skyscraper and Rampage, neither of those movies... Look, I wasn't expecting anything Oscar-worthy, really, out of the two of those, but I did expect, a pretty good time, pretty entertaining movies. And while they weren't terrible in their genres, they didn't stand out any at all either. They were pretty pedestrian. Bohemian Rhapsody, the four-time Oscar winner. I'm definitely on board with Rami Malek's Oscar win. His performance is great. Queen's music is great to hear. But as a movie, it also was pretty run-of-the-mill as far as musical bios go. I didn't think it had any particular great insight into Freddie Mercury or any of anybody else's character either in that movie. That was a bit of a disappointment. Widows. Widows that also picked up some good reviews. I didn't think was quite as good as a lot of the reviewers did. I loved a couple of the performances in the movie, particularly Elizabeth Debicki, but the movie overall wasn't near as suspenseful as I had hoped that it would be. Creed 2 was a little bit of a letdown. It was a competent movie, well shot. It lacked Coogler's... Lacked Coogler's sharp direction, though, and I thought the focus should have been more on Creed himself. But once again, Rocky Sylvester kind of overshadowed, in a good performance, mind you. He was good, but I really wanted to see more of Creed and less of Rocky in that movie. Clint Eastwood's The Mule. Another good performance from Eastwood. Interesting story, but that movie meandered way too much. It was not particularly involving, and it should have been. It would seem like it was going to be an interesting story, but it just failed to ignite. First Man, while I certainly, again, earlier told you the sound of that movie is terrific. Sound design was great. That movie was way too cold, I thought. And it might have been accurate to some degree as far as Armstrong's real-life character goes, but, you're making a movie, and it held you at too much of an arm's length to really care about what was going on. Much preferred, I would recommend going back and seeing The Right Stuff if you want to see some of that story told. Vice, I thought was way too one-sided. I know it's going to play it'll play to the audience it was intended to, and certainly there's a lot of that audience out in Hollywood. As we saw, Vice had quite a few Oscar nominations, but I prefer my bio movies to be at least try to be a little bit more even-handed. And while it boasted, again, great performances, the movie itself, I thought, was not as compelling as the acting. So while those movies are some of the worst and most disappointing movies I saw last year, I've saved the absolute worst to the end of this particular segment. The two worst movies I saw last year were Peppermint, starring Jennifer Garner, who, bless her heart, gave it her best shot. She's good in the film. She's certainly believable in the It's a very physically demanding film. And as she did in Alias on television, the J.J. Abrams series years ago, she is very convincing and delivers there, but it's just an unrelentingly stupid movie, in my opinion. And as well as Mile 22, the Peter Berg movie. Once again, he's teamed with his favorite actor, Mark Wahlberg, and Lauren Cohen co-stars from The Walking Dead and, well, and now Whiskey Cavalier. And that movie, I wanted to strangle Mark Wahlberg's character about, well, not too long after he started talking. It was just those two films together, just brutally, unrelentingly dumb movies. So, all right, that's enough. That's all the negativity I'm going to give. I don't do that very often, but every now and then I do have to let off a little steam. And now let me go on to a much more pleasant topic. Some of the best movies I saw last year. And there's quite a few. I think in the end, last year was a pretty good year for movies. Now, part of it, I wonder if the older I get, the more, I used to just go kind of scatter. I used to go see just about any movie. I wasn't quite as discerning. I may be a little bit more discerning now about what I spend my time on. And I don't know if that's necessarily a good thing. Look, you've got to see you've got to see some bad movies to help you remember and recognize what's good sometimes, right? And I did mention some of those bad ones. So, but there were a lot of fine films this year. A Quiet Place, I really enjoyed that. That was a great experience to go to the theater and have people. People normally don't care really if they're chomping on popcorn or you know, crinkling candy wrappers, whatever, just stuff that will annoy you for sure. In this movie, you could tell when somebody was, you know, when somebody was unwrapping candy, they did it ever so slowly and tried to do it as quietly as possible because the movie hinges on silences, and people were, and it's such a well-told story that moviegoers recognized that, and it was a nice experience within the theater to see that sometimes that people sometimes who don't seem to care about what they do within the theater really started caring in that movie. So, from one very solid horror sci-fi hybrid by a second-time feature director, in this case, John Krasinski, let's go to another very solid horror sci-fi hybrid from another second-time-out feature director. In this case, Alex Garland, and his movie is Annihilation. This movie was released very early last year, and it had a troubled release. Supposedly after a poor screen test, early screen test of the film, executive producer David Ellison was worried. He thought that maybe the film was a little too, and I believe his quotes were, too intellectual and too complicated for general audiences. And he wanted changes made in the film to, some might say, uncomplicate the film, while others might go with dumb it down to make it more palatable for a general audience. Unfortunately for him, producer Scott Rudin had final cut, and he refused to take Ellison's notes. So what Paramount ended up doing was they released the film in the U.S. and China. Paramount handled that. And then they let Netflix, I guess they sold a portion of the rights over to Netflix. And 3 weeks, I think it was like 2 or 3 weeks after the film was released theatrically, Netflix released it on their platform. And it's all rather unfortunate because some of the publicity and the strangeness of it may have actually hurt the film, or at least kept some people from seeing it in a theater where it certainly would have, I believe it would have played better. The effects were very cool and probably more conducive to being seen on a big screen. But nevertheless, the movie is very good, a cut above the average sci-fi and an average horror film, and a worthy follow-up to Garland's directorial feature movie of a couple of years ago, Ex Machina, which actually was an Academy Award winner. One last movie I would like to mention that slots into the horror category from last year is Ari Aster's directorial debut, Hereditary, starring the amazing Toni Collette. Hereditary, to me, is one of the better horror, straight-out horror movies of the last several years. And Collette's performance in the movie was my single favorite performance by any actor in any movie last year. It was just a virtuoso performance, a tightrope walk that if she had played it any differently, just if she had went a little further, the whole thing would have devolved into parody almost, or camp, but she didn't, and it's just a sight to behold. If only for that, that one thing, I would recommend the film. But overall, the film is just so assured of itself, especially from a first-time director. It's scary. It's oppressively unrelenting at times. It's not a feel-good movie by any means, and the last 5 minutes are a bit problematic for a lot of people, including myself. But nonetheless, go check that one out. And by the way, Collette's performance isn't the only really good performance in the movie. The younger actors as well, Alex Wolff and Millie Shapiro, who play her children in that movie, are exceptional as well. And last year, I thought, was a very good year all around for movies about teens, that are focused on teens. And three actually kind of stand out to me. There were more than three, but the ones I want to mention are Andrew Hayes' Lean on Pete, starring Charlie Plummer, Chloe Zhao's The Rider, starring a cast of non-professional actors basically playing versions of themselves, and Bo Burnham's debut, Eighth Grade, starring Elsie Fisher in what I think is the second best female performance of the year behind Toni Collette. All three of those movies take teenagers and what they have to deal with, what these characters have to deal with, and what a lot of teenagers in life have to deal with. It takes those problems very seriously, doesn't condescend to them, doesn't look down on them. And while all three movies don't blink their eyes as far as looking directly at some of the stresses that our kids have to go through today, they all still, despite some unflinching moments, I think they're all very positive to some degree, and they look forward with a good sense of hope. And sometimes that's kind of hard to find these days. And I think it's much needed. They certainly, it's not, again, neither of these movies, I don't think they offer easy ways out, for sure. They don't offer platitudes or false hope, but they do offer real hope, which is, you know, what kids need these days anyway, right? What all of us need. And speaking of looking at certain issues unflinchingly, there were several movies that involved racial themes this year that I thought stood out. We've already talked about one, BlacKkKlansman, certainly a very good movie. And along with that, I also would mention Sorry to Bother You, multi-hyphenate Boots Riley's audacious, in-your-face feature film debut that it's certainly not going to win over everybody. It's not for everybody, but those of you out there with a sense of adventure and a taste for social commentary, this is the ticket for you. This is just, it's just a real kick in the groin. I mean, I guess I mean that in a good way. And the more I think about this movie, the more I like it. I think I'm going to have to actually give that a second view pretty soon. And another film in the same vein that I also like quite a bit was Blindspotting, directed by Carlos Lopez Estrada. And that one kind of flew under the radar early, but nevertheless, it's definitely worthy of taking a look at. Another film that I like quite a bit that dealt with some racial matters, but in a totally different way, was Black Panther. Black Panther falling in more towards the action-filled blockbuster genre that of which there were also a couple of other entries that I thought stood a little bit over the rest that I saw, including Mission Impossible Fallout. The ageless wonder Tom Cruise comes in with the best version, the best edition of his Mission Impossible series yet. It is really a fun, entertaining movie. And another Marvel movie, actually, Avengers Infinity War. I could probably swap either Black Panther or Avengers Infinity War. I could swap either one of them back and forth if you asked me which one was better, just depend on what day you asked me. But all three of those movies that I mentioned there are a lot of fun, as are three of the animated films that I saw last year: Isle of Dogs, The Incredibles 2, and especially Spider-Man. Again, like I said earlier in the show, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. All three of those fun movies as well, with Spider-Man being a big standout. But if you're bent is more towards live actors instead of animated characters, then there were three films that I saw that I thought kind of, again, stood a little bit above some of the other films that I saw last year. Paul Schrader's First Reformed with Ethan Hawke, who turned in, I think, for me personally, the best male performance that I saw last year. Just totally gripping. Schrader, again, working with, it seems like, his favorite theme of a man inching towards a catharsis with violence. It's just first-rate stuff. And it's a theme that's somewhat employed by director Julian Schnabel's biopic of painter Vincent van Gogh in At Eternity's Gate, starring the wonderful Willem Dafoe. As most of us know, Van Gogh cut off his own ear in a moment of catharsis. And that whole movie is, well, again, kind of, it's one of those movies, not for everyone, but for those patient enough, I highly recommend that. And finally, Leave No Trace, starring the ever-intense Ben Foster and newcomer Thomasin McKenzie, a story about a father and his young daughter living off the grid, and about their attempted acclimation back into society. That film was directed by Deborah Granick, and I thought that she actually certainly should have at least been considered in the director's category. It was a fine job all around, both in the script, also written by Granick, and the acting. And finally, I want to mention three movies that somewhat exemplify kind of old school Hollywood. And not unsurprisingly, all three of these movies were nominated for Best Picture. And while maybe they're a little bit old fashioned to some degree, they're all prime examples of great storytelling. And for me, that's the most important thing a movie does. Tell a great story. And tell it in an entertaining fashion. And all of three of these movies, I thought, did that. And they were The Favorite, Green Book, and A Star Is Born. All three kind of in that old-fashioned, again, that old-fashioned mode. You've got the old musical biopic. And by the way, you know, A Star Is Born has been told, I think, at least four other times, starting back in the 30s. The Favorite, a beautifully mounted period piece. Certainly an old staple of Hollywood. And finally, Green Book. An old-fashioned road movie at its heart, and one that has a lot of heart with its messages of friendship and unity. And keeping with the themes of friendship and unity, I think I'm going to go ahead and close out this episode right here by saying, once again, thank you so much for tuning in. I really love doing this, and I love having you listen in. Whether you agree or don't agree, the ability to communicate and share things about this topic that we all love so much is the important thing. And again, I certainly encourage each and every one of you, if you have a thought or opinion about anything that you've heard today, please reach out to us on social media. You can find us on Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, Pinterest. We really would love to hear from you. Also, you can catch other episodes on iTunes, YouTube, Libsyn, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and Spotify. And do it soon. Don't procrastinate like your host. Until next time, everybody. Take care.